You want to wake up in the morning and think the future is going to be great. And that's what being a spacefaring civilization is all about. It's about believing in the future and thinking that the future will be better than the past. And I can't think of anything more exciting than going out there and being among the stars. These are the words of Elon Musk, a nerdy boy from South Africa who became a world-famous American engineering entrepreneur whose story is a lesson in how a few simple principles and work ethic that are applied relentlessly can yield astonishing results. Curious to know more about Elon Musk and how he developed his SpaceX company to get us off this planet? Keep watching. Elon Reeve Musk was born in 1971 in South Africa of a model, May Musk, and an electromechanical engineer, Errol Musk. He is the eldest of his siblings and a citizen of three countries, South Africa, Canada, and the United States. Musk spent his entire childhood reading encyclopedias and learning programming. In the summer of 1995, he moved to the Silicon Valley and registered in a PhD program in applied physics at Stanford University. 2 days after registration, Musk withdrew from the program. At that time, his younger brother, Kimball Musk, had just graduated from Queen's University with a business degree and came to join him in California. The early internet was a promising field, and they decided to launch an online business startup called Zip2. Shortly after launching their startup, the brothers found angel investors for Zip2 and built it into a successful company. In 1999, they sold it to the computer maker Compaq for approximately $280 million. After selling Zip2, Elon founded an online financial services company called X.com on his own. The main rival of X.com was another company called Confinity, which was founded by Peter Thiel and two others just months after X.com's launch. In March of 2002, the two companies merged and took on the same name of their main product, PayPal, which is a person-to-person online money transfer service. In October of 2002, the same year, eBay, the online auction service, bought PayPal for $1.5 billion. At the age of 31, Elon Musk, who had been the largest shareholder in PayPal with 11.7% of its equity shares, found himself possessing $165 million worth of eBay stock. After leaving PayPal, he has founded and co-founded many companies, two of which are SpaceX and Tesla Motors. He risked his entire early fortune building them up. The main focus of these two companies is addressing existential risks to the long-term survival of humanity, such as climate change risk, single planet dependency risk, and human species obsolescence risk. We will focus on SpaceX's evolution in this video, which was founded to solve the single planet dependency risk. According to Musk, humanity's long-term survival is at risk if it stays limited to just this one planet. Sooner or later, some disaster that could be natural, such as asteroids or supervolcanoes, or even man-made, such as nuclear war, will end our residency here. Musk founded Space Exploration Technologies Corp, or SpaceX, in May of 2002 to get us off the planet. He taught himself the necessary skills to design rockets, in addition to being Chief Technology Officer and CEO of SpaceX. He started with 11 employees. The most important of them is Gwynne Shotwell, who was put in charge of business development. Soon after being hired, Shotwell established herself as Musk's right-hand woman at SpaceX. She became a legend in the space tech world, and the SpaceX company may have failed without her. The story began in 2002, when Shotwell had a brief conversation with Musk, and 2 weeks later, she was working for him as the company's seventh employee. The company's first rocket, the single-engine Falcon 1, failed 3 times before it successfully carried a satellite into space in 2008. In the same year, NASA awarded SpaceX a $1.6 billion contract to transport cargo in 12 flights to the space station. In addition to this contract, SpaceX has inked commercial contracts with more than $4 billion to launch satellites aboard its larger Falcon 9 rocket for various countries and telecommunications companies. Most of these contracts were awarded to SpaceX thanks to Shotwell's PR skills, Consequently, SpaceX has gone from a startup with half a dozen employees to a major government contractor with nearly $5 billion in contracts and more than 3,000 people on its payroll. SpaceX launches timeline. Number 1. Falcon 1. In September of 2008, Falcon 1 became the first privately developed liquid-fuel rocket to reach Earth's orbit. Falcon 1's first launch attempt came on November 26, 2005, at 5:11 p.m. Musk played down the chances of success, telling reporters that the likelihood of a new rocket launching from a new launch pad on its first attempt was low. Musk's prediction proved right on the mark when the launch had to be scrubbed when an auxiliary liquid oxygen, or LOX, fill tank had a manual vent valve incorrectly set to vent. The time it took to correct the problem resulted in too much LOX boiling off, and too much helium was lost. Since LOX was used to chill the helium bottles, the loss of the LOX meant that there was no way to cool the bottles. The launch team managed to refill the LOX tanks, but the rate at which they could add helium was slower than the rate at which LOX was boiling away, so the decision was taken to scrub. Launch attempt number 2 took place on December 19, 2005, but a structural issue with the first stage fuel tank, a faulty valve caused a vacuum in the first stage fuel tank which sucked inward and caused structural damage, resulted in another scrub. After replacing the first stage, the launch of Falcon 1 was set to take place on February 10, 2006. Despite the first two scrubs, Musk was unfazed, telling reporters that hiccups were to be expected with the debut of any new launch system, adding that each launch attempt brought valuable experience to the flight team. True enough, but it was probably experience that the flight team was growing weary of, especially when launch attempt number 3 resulted in a scrub after problems cropped up during a planned engine test. Saturday, March 25th, 2006 was the date set for launch attempt number 4. This time, the launch proceeded according to plan. 1 minute before launch, Falcon 1 switched to the computerized launch sequence. Seconds before launch, a spark lit, which fired a turbopump spinning at 21,000 RPM, pushing LOX and kerosene into the Falcon's main engine combustion chamber. A moment later, flames erupted beneath the Falcon, generating 72,000 pounds of thrust. That was as good as it got. Immediately following liftoff, the vehicle rolled, rocking back and forth, and then at T plus 26 seconds, rapidly pitched over. Impact occurred at T plus 41 seconds into a dead reef less than 100 meters from the launch site. The Falcon sat two payloads separated from the booster and landed on the island, sustaining minor damage. After poring over video footage, data points, and flight telemetry, the cause of the launch failure was identified as a small fire that had broken out on the first stage engine. The fire had been caused by a fuel leak, and the cause of the fuel leak was an aluminum nut from the fuel pump. The nut had cracked, having corroded in the salty, humid air. The choice to go with aluminum fittings rather than more durable stainless steel had been a cost-saving decision. In the business of launching rockets, weight equals money, and that meant choosing aluminum over stainless steel. Unfortunately, that aluminum had been sitting in the humid tropical environment for 10 weeks, with predictable and costly results. Before moving on, be sure to like or dislike the video so that we can continue to improve our content and make these videos better for you. Plus, be sure to subscribe to the channel and don't forget to hit the bell button so that you don't miss any of our weekly videos. In September of 2008, Falcon 1 rose from the launch pad, accelerating quickly on a burst of flame. At 37,000 feet, it reached maximum dynamic pressure, known as max Q, an event that was followed by first stage separation. As the long second stage nozzle glowed white hot, the team in El Segundo popped champagne corks. 300 seconds into the flight, the rocket's second stage started to spin and wobble. 3 minutes later, the stage was spinning faster. The second stage engine flamed out, but the rocket continued to roll. At 11 minutes, 11 seconds into flight, the video feed went blank. Regardless, Musk claimed success with the launch of the vehicle. After all, he had gotten his rocket farther into space than any company ever had, with an engine designed entirely from scratch. all the major milestones were met, and the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, DARPA, reps had walked away happy, impressed at how quickly the SpaceX team had refueled the beefed-up Falcon 1. With the successful launch of Falcon 1, Musk could look to the future, part of which was to help humanity become a space-faring civilization. To achieve that goal, he knew he had to establish a blueprint that followed a path of ever-increasing capability and reliability while simultaneously reducing costs, goals he had alluded to in his Senate testimony in 2004. By following this plan, Musk hoped to ultimately reduce the cost of launching vehicles into orbit and increase the reliability of space access by a factor of 10. It was a bold ambition, but Musk believed that by eliminating the traditional layers of management internally and subcontractors externally, SpaceX could reduce its cost and accelerate decision-making and delivery. He also believed that by keeping most of the manufacturing in-house, SpaceX could reduce its costs, keep tighter control of quality, and ensure a tight feedback loop between the design and manufacturing teams. And by concentrating on simple, proven designs, with a primary focus on reliability, Musk was sure SpaceX could reduce the costs associated with complex systems operating at the margin. Coupled with the newly emerging market for private and commercial space transport, Musk hoped that his new model for reaching orbit would reignite humanity's efforts to explore and develop space. Number 2. First Land Landing. On December 21, 2005, the Falcon 9 rocket delivered 11 communication satellites to orbit, and the first stage returned and landed at Landing Zone 1, the first ever orbital-class rocket landing. Number 3. Droneship Landing. On April 8, 2016, the Falcon 9 rocket launched the Dragon spacecraft to the International Space Station, and the first stage returned and landed on the Of Course I Still Love You droneship. Number 4. First Reflight. On March 30th, 2017, SpaceX achieved the world's first reflight of an orbital-class rocket. Following delivery of the payload, the Falcon 9 first stage returned to Earth for the second time. Number 5. Falcon Heavy First Flight. Falcon Heavy is the world's most powerful operational rocket by a factor of 2, capable of carrying large payloads to orbit and supporting missions as far as the Moon or Mars. On February 7, 2018, Falcon Heavy made its first launch to orbit, successfully landing two of its three boosters and launching its payload to space. Number 6. Crew Dragon docks with ISS. Crew Dragon docked with the International Space Station on March 3, 2019 at 3:02 a.m. Pacific Standard Time, becoming the first American spacecraft to autonomously dock with the orbiting laboratory. Colonizing Mars. Even when Mars is at its closest approach, the Red Planet is 150 times farther than the Moon. Over the decades, dozens of manned Mars mission architectures have been suggested, all of which have been obscenely expensive. But Musk reckons he can charge his passengers, or colonists, just $500,000 US. While Musk has a vehicle in mind, reusable of course, the real challenge will be making the numbers work. Of course, one way to do this is reusability. Traditionally, rockets are thrown away after every flight, which is a terrible way to do business, especially if you plan to send 80,000 people to a distant planet. But Musk reckons he can fix the problem of reusability, and by doing so, drive down mission costs to just tens of thousands of dollars per kilogram to low Earth orbit. If he does that, then he'll be in a good position to charge budget prices for seats aboard his colony spaceship. 80,000 people on Mars sounds like science fiction to most people, especially when you consider no government agency has even come close to sending just one astronaut there. But until a few years ago, a commercial assembly line for spacecraft didn't exist. Don't forget, we're talking about a visionary, someone who pushed way beyond the envelope to achieve what many thought was downright impossible. Thanks for watching, everyone. Do you think we can colonize Mars one day? Can you guess the edge of the SpaceX company? Did you learn anything new in this video? Let me know in the comments below. Be sure to subscribe, and I'll see you next time on the channel.